Welcome, Rebel Nation. Thanks for joining us on today's podcast. A few days ago, we had a restoration roundtable where we discussed where we're going in the next few weeks with sort of our narrative, for lack of a better word, our direction, how we want to coach and train and continue to grow the 2.0 movement. And Joe Ledbetter talked about relationships. Not relationships between, you know, you and your spouse. I don't think any of us are qualified to help you with that. But relationships with employees, adjusters, agents, carriers at the higher level, you know, the desk adjusters. And so we thought we would start this initiative talking to an expert in agent relationships. But before I bring Jerry Edel on, and this is going to be a powerful 45 to 60 minutes, we'll try not to go too much over that because Jerry's going to be speaking at the summit May 4th and 5th, and I hope you're going to be there. Before we go into that, I want to frame this and give you my experience with really bad agent marketing. And it's probably the agent marketing that you've tried, and it's probably the agent marketing that you hate. So, like Jerry, I worked for a franchise system, a much smaller franchise system. But we found ourselves, wherever we could put our logo, we would then sell this at a markup to our franchisees. So think about this for a minute. The mothership, the franchisor, is producing a lot of brochures and pamphlets and tchotchkes and pens and things like that. And we're selling them to the franchisees and we're telling you, go out and market to agents. So that's problem number one. There is a clear bad motivation on the franchisor's part to push this out. So I would go out on a limb to say this entire concept of agent marketing started with a pretty selfish premise, probably from some of the larger franchise systems. That's just theory. You can send hate mail, john@unitedresource.com, and we can debate it. But then the transaction itself is totally meaningless, but it feels good. So think about this. You have your salesperson going out there, or you're going out there in your downtime. You're taking your $5, $6, $7, $12 packet of information and probably some candy or some donuts, and you're dropping this off with a local agent. You measure quote unquote success in the number of people you spoke with that day and the number of packets you dropped off, or candy you dropped off, or donuts you dropped off. And in the same fashion, the person receiving that information measures quote unquote success by just getting you out of their lobby and out of their office. So we both feel good. The transaction feels good to both parties, but we all know that the material ends up in the trash within 30 seconds. So that's waste. And the donuts go to somebody's waste. It's all waste. So Jerry comes from the perspective that he's got a better idea, a better way of doing this. So understand, we are not pushing traditional candy agent marketing. Jerry Edel, thank you so much for taking an hour out of your day to talk with us. What is your take on this? What's the secret sauce, Jerry?
Well, thank you. I mean, I love how you set that up. I mean, you couldn't have set that up any better, because that what you describe is what we have done for years. And I will admit, because I was there when we started doing that, that stuff worked because no one was out there doing anything. The agent was virtually ignored by most of the industry. And so because it was so new, it worked. But right. That was 20 years ago, 15 years ago, we still did it. 10 years ago, I started to notice the results aren't there like they used to be. I mean, it's not working the way it should work. And something's changing in their industry. And of course, we all know what that is. It's the internet. The internet is, I mean, amongst many other things, of course, but that's a big driver. And the world has changed in the last 10 years and is changing rapidly in the last 5 years. And the agent world is very different today. So, you know, that traditional, I've got a list, I've got them geo-mapped on routes, and I make the rounds, and I stop in, and I drop something off, and I roll on to the next office, just is not what I want to talk about, because that's been there, done that, and honestly, those who are still doing it, good for you. You know, I mean, I hope it's working for you, But most people I talk to are saying, yeah, that the results just haven't been there like they used to be. And there's a reason why, all of that. But that is the traditional sense. So, you know, what I'm going to talk about is what I like to call the new agent marketing 2.0. And I will give credit where it's due. I mean, I took 2.0 summit, you know, at Restoration Rebels and said, that's right. You know, we need a do-over. We need to start this thing over. And that's really what this is about. And I've been 5 years, six now, working on this product and making this work again. Because, you know, like you, Jonathan, I grew up in the industry. I made my living selling insurance agents, insurance adjusters, and I get what that is like and what that's all about. And when something that I used to do worked and now it doesn't anymore, I wanted to know why. I wanted to understand it and fix it if I could. And I'm excited today. I get passionate about this. I get wound up over this. So feel free to cut me off when you need to. But I got to tell you, Jonathan, there's a better way. There's a better way, and I'm going to share those things with you right now. So,
well, let's give you a little bit of street cred for those who may not know you. You spent 35 years. Is that an accurate 34?
34, 35 years as a working full time in the franchise business,
and for the largest franchise system cleaning.
Yeah. Yeah,
slash restoration system in the country.
The top two will argue which is the largest, but you know who.
Of course,
we don't need to mention the colors or the names.
So you're not a fly by night. You know, you had a shower thought one morning and decided I'm going to go after restorers. You are a restorer at heart. So
you know, absolutely. I love that. I love that statement. I say this to people all the time. I didn't cook this up in some corporate, you know, office suite someplace in a cubicle. You know?
Right.
That's, you know, this thing has come out of years of my own experience, years of R&D, thousands and thousands of hours working with people doing this, making this work. And we've broken the code. We've cracked the code. We know how to open that safe. That vault is opening now. And you can get the right agents to recommend you when you do it the right way.
Right. So when we talked yesterday, you mentioned we might have a different understanding of certain terms, right? So when we say agent marketing, you're calling it new agent marketing or new agent marketing 2.0. Let's talk terminology. Let's clear that up first. No, we're talking about the same thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Just to be clear, when our industry uses the words agent marketing, the image is routes, rounds, candy, stop, drop, roll, that kind of stuff.
Right.
That's not what we're going to talk about today. We're still going to go talk to agents, but we're going to do it in a different way with a different value proposition, a different message to them. So when I talk about agent, when I use that word agent marketing, I'm saying new agent marketing, and really it's agent sales.
Okay.
And that is different. And you'll see how that comes into play here as we go through this.
Okay, so why don't we start with, let's say I'm a man in a van in operation. I'm maybe doing, you know, under 800,000 a year, and I want to tap in to these local agents. And maybe let's say I'm in a market of less than 250,000 people.
Sure.
I've grown up here. I know the market. That describes a huge majority of our Rebel base.
Yes.
Where do I start in this process?
Well, I always like to begin with, you know, why agents? Why go after them at all? What's the return on investment? How does that work? How long before I'm going to see that return on investment? And one of the things that I counsel people all the time on is don't go into this field of going after insurance agents to get them to recommend you over your competitors unless you're prepared to invest over the long haul, because this, you're right. I mean, it's always sales is always a relationship business, right? I mean, it's a transactional relationship built on trust. First, they got to know you, like you, and trust you, right? Mm-hmm. You know those fundamentals. And that takes a certain amount of time. But in the agent world, what I have observed in the last 5 years of doing this with the system that I'm going to share with you today, just which is the tip of the iceberg, but I'm going to share the key parts of it that anybody can take and put to work today. And that system, my system, I tell people, this is like planting an orchard. Okay. I mean, you got to think in terms of I'm planting an orchard and this is going to take time. And that's number one. And so you have to be able to know what's your return on investment over time. Yes, you can go into an agent office and dumb luck will have it. They just happen to have a loss that day and they think you're the first card on top of the file and they call you, you know, and that's dumb luck and I'll take it and thank you. I'm grateful for it. But at the end of the day, that's not the ROI we're going to talk about. What I've observed is it isn't until after month six of doing a system, after month six, you can count the next, you can clock it out and track it on a piece of paper on a spreadsheet if you want to. You can see the results beginning to build. And we have measured and seen a sales professional bring in $1 million from new business from insurance agents alone, specifically in the mitigation category, not reconstruction.
Wow.
That would be over and above. And I've seen that result, and I've learned from studying this that first 6 months is you learning a new process, developing the right habit, and getting the agent and their staff to see, oh, you're different. This is entirely different. And when I go through what that value proposition is, this will make sense to you, because we're going to change our position big time with the right agent. And when you do that, it still takes them and their staff time to put that system in play, to call you.
Right. One thing I've noticed over the years of working with Restores is I think given the nature of emergency services and being on call 24/7, it is a challenge. If you are an owner operator, it's a challenge to be consistent in anything. Your holidays aren't consistent. Your anniversaries and birthdays aren't consistent, because if that big call comes in, you're dropping everything you're going and you're running and you're chasing the work. So talking about consistency in 6 months before they're really beginning to see the first, you know, seedlings appear or the plants sprouting through the soil. Is there a better time of the year to start this in? Is there a better group of agent to start going after first? What does that look like?
Yeah. The answer to the time of year is the best time to have started this was 6 months ago. The second best time of day, hence the Chinese proverb on planting an apple tree. Right.
Right. You know?
So put that aside in terms of, you know, what does it take? If you're a full-time sales professional out there, you're not the owner operator guy in the truck getting it done that you've first described. If you're a full-time sales professional, you're going to be invest. This is you're going to do this all day. This is every day. This is day-to-day task. But I work with a lot of just owner operators that have got a few guys working for them, a few production people on their staff, and they're wearing the hats, all the hats. They're doing everything. And it's like, listen, can you give me one day a week? Probably not. Can you give me 1 hour a day? Well, maybe I can. All right, let me dial that in tighter. Can you see five agents a week? One a day? Well, most people will get their head around that and say, well, yeah, I can do that.
Right.
And if you can do that, I can show you a return on investment.
Are these initial meetings, are they 10 minutes, half hour, hour?
Oh, that's going to vary. That's going to get deeper into the strategy itself. And I don't want to get too far into that today.
Sure.
Because, you know, you can get sidelined on that. To answer the quick answer to you is the first few visits can be 5 minutes.
Okay.
But when you're ready to sit down with the right person, that might be 30 minutes, that might be 45 minutes, but you're going to make the sale at that point. So that's a down the road.
Right. I'm imagining the comments when we post this. And so I'm putting myself in the shoes of the boots of the Restorer, saying, okay, five agents a week. That's a, you know, let's say it's a 10 minute meeting. It's some drive time in there, and I'm trying to boil down how much time am I investing per week? Because the reality is, if it's 2 or 3 hours a week, we can find the time to do it. If we know in our consistency, this is going to become a huge percentage of our new business year after year after year.
After year, wouldn't you? After year after year.
You know, we throw money at AdWords. We throw money at SEO. We throw money, you know, but we need to invest a little bit of time in this too. Yeah. It's actually far cheaper than something like AdWords or SEO. So I'm tracking with you. All Talk right. to me about the right agent versus there a wrong agent?
I definitely want to, first thing I want to do is talk about the right agent, because yes, there's a wrong agent. But before we do, let this, for the audience that's sitting out there saying, I've never done agent marketing, I've never done all the traditional stuff, why would anybody go after agents?
Okay,
but I think this will help us a little bit. 2005, there was a study done by the Boston Consulting Group that I was a part of with that franchise company that I worked for then. And one of the statistics, there's a couple of statistics I'll share with you today on this call, but one of the statistics that came out of that was the average agents, when you put all of them together, divided by the number, you get an average, right? And the average is 20 property casualty losses a year. Now, you can argue that, and we can debate that, but it's a number that it was validated by them, and it is a way of looking at the return on investment. Because when you think about, if the average agent has 20 losses, property casualty, and your average claim's $3,500, just say it's just that, you know, that's 70 grand.
Right.
Times 100 agents.
That's a good segment of your business.
There's 7 million. If you've got a couple hundred agents in the market you described, under 200,000, probably got a couple hundred agents. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you're talking about $14 million worth of business, and it might be more, it might be less. Don't worry about that. The point is, the agent has, going through their book of business, their clientele, their customer list, they have the opportunity to touch that many people. So, you know, when you look at that, and when I look at that kind of a number and I start to think about the return on investment, I'm going to go back now to that owner operator that I work with that says, man, Jerry, I think I can do one a day. I can see 5 agents a week. I'll get 5 done. I'll do that consistently. All right. Look, you're going to end up, if you can end up in a 2-week rotation, right? You're going to see 5 this week, and then next week you're going to see a different 5, and then I'm going to have you go back every 2 weeks, right? With the right system, the right questions, trust me, this works. You can go in. And so what's going to happen is you're drawing on a total of 10, right? I mean, that's all right. Now, if you do the math on 10, and if those 10 only sent you 5, just 5, okay, not 20. Let's just say they averaged 20, but they only can control 5 of them.
Right.
Okay. All right. So we know then, if I've got 10 that send me 5, that's, I've got 50 losses, right?
Right.
Okay. Times $3,500, $175,000. And for many restorers, timeout, that's all. I don't want to add more than 200,000 this year. I can't handle it. I don't have the capacity to handle it.
Right.
For others, it's like, I can double that. Okay, let's get 20. And we'll do that over time, right? And so when I look at just the ability to call on 10, get 10 of them into a system like this, and you can get just 5, the return on investment can be significant, because you know your gross margin. If it's not TPA work, vendor work, that you're charging your 10 and 10s, you're charging all of the line item pricing, and you don't have the administrative burden, and you don't have all the fees that go along with it, and all the taxation that you get in those crazy programs,
right?
Your margin is significant, as it should be. You know, and I watched Andy's podcast yesterday. You know, and he's talking about, you want to take care of your employees, well, you need to charge the price so that you can afford to pay them, right? And that's what this is about. And so I make a strong case for, if you're not looking at agents, okay, that's fine. But if you want to go after them, trust me, the return on investment is there for those who do it right.
I agree. Several years ago, I wrote an article called the Death of the Preferred Vendor Program. And I talked about how what an agent does for the carrier has changed dramatically over the last several years. And I thought back, my dad was a small business owner, had a very successful business, but small business. And so we had, you know, a house and tons of vehicles and lots of employees. And I know my dad always worked with the same agent his entire professional life. When he needed something, a new life policy, added a new car, we changed homes, he called his insurance guy. And come loss time, we survived. It wasn't that bad. We survived Hurricane Andrew in South Florida in the 90s. And we came home to a giant tree through our kitchen atrium and shutters blown off and siding messed up and trees down all over the yard. And my dad didn't call a 800 number, didn't call a call center. He called his agent. And his agent was his risk manager. And right. My dad was just as worried about his premium going up. And so he was responsible to not file claims without, you know, a clear basis for it. Mm-hmm. But that agent, he was his insurance guy. And nowadays it's about new lines and not even so much about retention, I think, with some of the younger agents. And I speak from experience. For a very short time, uh-huh. I was a life, health, and accident producer for a very large national insurance carrier. So I kind of saw it from that perspective. They were all about sell life policies and to new people. Retention, we'll think about that later. So if we are bringing in the agent, if the agent is literally turning over a property loss to us, they're sort of now interwoven in the claim process, right? They have a dog in the fight at this point.
Yeah, that's a great term for us to define, because we hear all the time, well, we're not involved. Agents are not involved in the claim process. My answer to that is correct. Now, 20 years ago, they were.
Exactly.
30 years ago, they were the adjuster. They wrote the check, right? We know all of that. That those days are gone, obviously, for the most part. But when we say, and when we hear the word, I'm not involved, we're not involved with claims, we turn it over to the claim department, what they're referring to is the adjusting of the claim.
Sure.
But there are those who also recognize that's true, but before it gets to that point, there's something that I want to call customer service, right?
Right.
And I've learned as an agent, don't separate your service from your sales, right?
Right.
And so this is where I want to talk next with you is about the right agent. I mean, let's define that right there, because you've outlined a great example of the right agent and the wrong agent. And again, I'm going to go back again to that research that was done in 2005. And one of the statistics that came out of this is 30% of all agents, and this was a national study from all kinds, brands, carriers across the board. It was a great study. It was a statistically sound study. Over 400 and some odd people were involved in this study. And one of the statistics was 30% of the agents do not get involved and help their customer with any kind of advice. It's a philosophy thing. Now, when I first heard that, I thought that's wrong. This study is bogus. That's not correct, because no normal person would think that way, right?
Yeah.
And then it hit me. It took me a while, but I eventually caught on. Wait a minute, Jerry, you're approaching this from your perspective, which is I'm a service guy.
Right.
And a service company can never do that. But a sales company can.
Of course, yeah.
And so there is this philosophy that exists. And by the way, today, while I'm not aware of any new studies, I've been monitoring the trend, and it seems clear that it's no longer 30%. I think it's up to 40% now. I think in some markets it's more than that, but in other markets it's not, depending upon, you know, several factors that we don't need to get into right now. But the agent that does not get involved has a philosophy that says, I'm here for sales. And this is, you see this a lot in the new people, newer agents. I want to be careful not to call newer agents the younger millennial generation because right. they have a different twist. The millennials have a different spin on this. We're seeing more millennials actually get involved with giving service, advice, being that advisor, than we are some of that are a little bit older than them. But the newer agents are drinking the Kool-Aid from corporate that says, don't get involved. But one of the unintended consequences, a side effect, if you will, of don't get involved with the claim, turn it over to our award-winning claim department and you go sell, right. is your customer says, well, why am I buying insurance from you? Why don't I just get it online? I mean, what you don't do anything right. for me. You right. just took my money. And so there's another agent, and back in 2005, it was 70%. Today, it's more like 60%. But 60% of the agents out there today, I believe, are in the category that have the philosophy that says, yeah, I don't get involved with the claim. I'm not an adjuster. That's not what I do. But listen, to their customer, when they have the point of sale, they're thanking them for their business and they're reassuring them, listen, if you need anything, if you need to buy more insurance, you want to talk about your coverage, call me. Mm-hmm. If you have a loss, if you have any problems, call me first. Let me be your advisor. Okay. Right. That's what they want to be. And those are by definition the right agents. And the wrong agents are the other people that are on that list, that route that everybody's out there doing candy drops to.
Right.
And other stuff and CE and all of those and golf and all of those kinds of things. I get all of that. I understand all of that. I've been there and done that. I'm telling you, the ROI isn't there because that group of people have a philosophy that says, and they'd say this to their customer, thank you for your business. If you need to buy any new coverage, any new policies, I'm your guy. Call me. If you have a loss, please. They flip the card over. They point to the number. And they say, call the 800 number. They're an award-winning claim department. They're right. going to take great care of you, right? And they haven't learned that that's the Kool-Aid that's going to kill them right. eventually, okay? Right. So, you know, that's what I mean when I talk about the right agent. You got to target the right one. And unfortunately, you cannot tell from their website. Now, you can get a ton of information about the agent on their website, but you cannot tell this. This takes a face-to-face conversation. It has to be live. You have to read all of the signs. You can get a certain amount over the phone, but when you go face-to-face, belly-to-belly, nose-to-nose, you can see all of the other nonverbal communication. And with the right questions, you can begin to identify 40%, 60%. And I'm an old cleaner. So I'm the guy that was, when I started, before I was full-time, I was a kid in high school, we used buckets, right? We had a clean water bucket and a dirty water bucket. You know what I'm going to say, right?
Yeah.
Take the 40% of them and put them in the dirty water bucket and throw that out and quit wasting your time with them.
Right.
Take this, and the good news is most everybody's competition is calling on all of them because they don't know how to sort them out. Take that 60% focus on that group, and within that group, let's get 10, then we'll get 10 more. And then if you can handle it, we'll get 10 or 20 more.
Yeah.
You know, and somewhere around 40, you're done. You can't handle one sales professional full-time can't handle any more than that. And there's reasons for that, and it has to do with the value proposition.
So can you bullet point a few questions that we could ask to begin to determine who's in the 60%?
Yeah, I'm going to do that for you. Okay. I'm going to give you a golden question that's going to help you sort Hit that me. Out and figure that out. Okay. I'm going to do that. Which but you're doing a great job, man. Thank you. It's just segue. You set me up perfectly for my last real point. I mean, I've only got three things to tell people, all right? Okay. I mean, you know, it's why agents, the right agent, and you got to add value to them. And it's in the adding value that I'm going to give you that question that you're
okay. going
to have. All right. So here's the thing. We have to add value, and we all will admit, no thinking person is not going to admit, that bringing candy and dropping donuts and being polite and hi, how are you, and talking about whatever and having, you know, contests and quizzes and prizes and all of that fun stuff,
right?
Might make nice friendships, and you can call them relationships, but I'm going to tell you they're not productive. Okay. The purpose of what we do is to be productive and have productive relationships with people.
Right.
And in order for us to do that, we have to add value to them and their business, right? Okay. And those who do are going to go further than those who don't, right? So we want to add value. And this is where it gets tricky. People who do what I do, consultants who do what I do, teach this process, most all of us will tell you there are only three things that insurance agents want. Everything that they want boils down to and distills into this funnel of just three things. Let me give them to you. You know what they are. Okay. They want to keep their customers. Duh.
Right.
Okay. Number two, they want to have a profitable business, a profitable book of business. That's their loss ratio. And they want to earn a profitability bonus. Absolutely.
Sure.
And number three, they're going to tell you they want new business. Okay. All right. So that's the standard value proposition. If you, you know, the consultants that are out there will tell you, answer those three questions and you're going to get their business, right? Again, I'm going to tell you that that's a myth. And I don't, you might get some comments coming now from what I'm about to say, because this is personal, because this is all I have. This is what I have to offer. And I'm going to tell you it's a myth if you think that you can help that agent. I want to be real careful now, because somebody's going to hit the stop button and delete right now. but I'm going to risk it. If you think that customer retention, you can impact customer retention, that's a myth. And here's why I say it.
Okay.
The agent will say to you, and I've heard them do this, and anybody who calls on them will hear them say, you know, hey, just do a good job. Just take care of my customer and do a good job. That's kind of the two things they say, right? Why do they say that? Well, we know, you know, we assume, well, they want us to take care of their customer because they care about retention. And of course, when you talk with an agent, of course they're going to say to you, oh, yeah, customer satisfaction, help me keep my customers, right? I mean, of course they're going to say that. What else are they going to say? Doesn't mean that that's enough to get them to want to stick their neck out and send you out on their losses. So right. let me unpack this for you, because I know where this is going to go. You know, think about, why does the agent lose a customer? Now, think about it. Just think about it, because what I just asked you, for anyone who's listening that's out there now calling on agents, I'm going to reframe the question, because this is a golden question. This is one of my best questions anybody can ask an insurance agent. I'm telling you, insurance agents want to answer the question. If I go to you, if you're my agent, if you're an agent I'm talking to, Jonathan, you're right. A prospective agent. And I say, Jonathan, I'm curious, what causes you to lose customers? I guarantee you, you're going to want to talk to me about that, because it's your business. They're your customers. You, this is heavy on your mind. You're thinking about this a lot. So when you ask that agent that question, the top five reasons that you're going to hear are not going to have anything to do with you contractors causing me to lose customers.
Hmm.
Now, we think it does. We would think it would, but think about this. When you ask them, the number one reason they lose customers is got more to do with the underwriting department canceling them because they had a claim. Or worse, the underwriting department jacks up their rates,
right?
And they quit, right? So we call that price. Well, that's a price issue after they've been sold. They didn't lose them as a prospect. They lost them as a customer. Both of those things are completely out of the agent's control.
The realm. Yeah.
And they're totally out of your control. You can have a 5-star Google review, customer satisfaction, go in, hand them the piece of paper and show it to them, and the agent's going to say, well done. Good. Of course they are. It matters. And please don't hear what I'm not saying. It's important. Yeah. I believe it's important. We have to take care of the customer. Right.
But that is, as restorers, that is out of our control completely. We have no impact.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. It's out of our control, and it's not enough. You know, so when you go through this and you think about, wait a minute, they've only got on average 20 property casualty losses, and they can't get me out on all of them. That's not going to happen. It's fantasy to think it will. You could ask for all of it, but in the end, you're not going to get all of it because they can't control all of it. So you can't, even if you had 100% customer sat, in the end, they're still going to lose customers, right? They know this matters, but it's a myth if you think that's enough. So here's what I like to say. It's part of the combination that unlocks the safe. So yes, you need to do it, but if that's all you've got, if that's your only bullet in your gun, you're going to get a lot of polite stuff and you're going to get some losses coming to them. But I mean, you won't see on a spreadsheet five losses in a 12-month period of time.
Okay.
You'll get one or two. That'll be it. Okay.
Okay.
So it's a myth. How are we doing? How many people you think have shut me down already?
No, I'll tell you this. It's challenging my thinking because I've thought that for years that, well, if we go in and we do a good job and we ally with the agent and with the adjuster as much as we can, and we do what's best, we put the customer first. We're all about customer centric, customer first within the 2.0 movement. I thought the natural product of that process was retention for the agent, but you've challenged me enough to where I'm going to sit and digest that a bit, but you're kind of right. Those things are out of our control.
They really are. When as a sales professional, I ask agents that question, it's empowering to them and it will feed into the last value prop I'm going to give you today.
Okay.
Because it's a key part of it. But that agent will not, the number one and number two items on their list isn't going to be because of all you contractors.
Right.
Okay, it's just we don't impact it enough. Yes, it's important. I'm
right.
Absolutely a believer in that, okay? But let's turn that coin over. There's kind of two sides to the coin of customer service and do a good job. You know, those two get used almost interchangeably, but they're two separate things.
Okay.
Take care of the customer is about retention. But we also hear do a good job. We hear that and we know that means do your job right.
Right.
Right. Be top shelf at what you do. Do what's needed. Don't tear the place apart and rebuild it and give me a bill for, you know, $250,000 when it should have been a $10,000 loss.
Right.
Right. Okay. So that impacts their loss ratio.
Okay.
Right. And loss ratio does matter. And if I go in with my value proposition and I say, listen, we can save you money. We can lower your loss costs. And I've done that. And I've been a part of that franchise system that sat in the, and I'm not going to say names because they get real touchy when you start using company names, right? But we all know who the biggest property casualty insurer is in the United States, all right? Everybody knows who that is. And if you don't, just call me and I'll tell you who they are. Okay.
Yeah.
But I sat in their home office, in their headquarters, with the senior VP over all of claims year after year. And I heard them say, help us get our agents, help us get the word out to our agents to put more losses through the program because we're saving them so much money.
Okay.
And the statistics on mitigation alone absolutely prove, there's no question, it lowers their loss, their severities, and therefore the agent has a win off of it. And we used to do that. And yet, year after year, they never got the message. Wait, no, we did. We delivered. We helped you. We would do this for them. And every year, they would report the most we've got through our program. This is the largest in the nation. The most we've got through vendor programs is 17%. And they wanted to get up to 40. That was their goal. It was like a dream.
Wow.
And they never got more than 17%. But we kept going back because they asked us to, the carrier asked us to, the claim department asked us, please go out to our agents because they're influencers. We know they are, right?
Okay, now, let me stop you, Jerry. I want to make sure I'm understanding the right figure you just gave us. They were only able to put 17% of all property losses through their vendor program?
Yeah.
That's an incredible number.
Yeah, it's staggering when you know their size. It's unbelievable. And you know, I look at that and there's a couple of things that come out of it. First, they know agents are influencers.
Right.
So don't tell me agents are not in the game. Number two, there's something wrong with that message.
Yeah.
I mean, they added to it, customer sat. Show them that we got happy customers. It's like, right. You're so disconnected from the front line, your own underwriting department is canceling them and jacking their rates up. You're driving them away. It's not because of service. Right. And the agent is sitting there as a self-employed business owner who owns that agency. They're the principal, they're that broker, and they're saying, that's nice that you can help me with my loss ratio, and that is. And that's nice that you can help me with my customer sat, and that is. And they'll smile at you, and they'll smile at their corporate who comes in their office and says, please use the program. And guess what they'll do? They'll smile and say, absolutely. Yeah, we're not involved. Right?
Right.
And then they turn around and they use their influence to help their customer get the contractor who's going to do things that they want done, and because those things matter to them, but it's not quite enough. You got to go beyond that. It's part of the combination. It's the second. Think of it as a, you know, those old movies with the old safes and the you got to crack the code, you got to turn the knob, you know, so far this way, and it clicks and you hear it tumble, tumbler click in. There's four of these.
Four tumblers.
Okay. Yeah, you got the first two now. Customer satisfaction, lower the loss costs. That's important. Absolutely. Those are part of it. But by itself, it's not enough. And that's the myth. If you think it's enough, it's a myth. You're mistaken. And that's why your results are declining. And if you keep track of your numbers, there may be some exceptions out there. And I guarantee you somebody's going to write in and say, he's full of, you know what, because, you know, my numbers are this. And you know what? You're good for you. You're out there. And I'm going on record saying there's exceptions out there, right?
Sure.
But the majority of you out there are going, he's right. You're hearing this going, that makes sense. Just like it's starting to make sense for you. Let me give you the third myth.
Okay.
Consultants will say, you know, agents want new business. And if you can help them, you're win. Listen, of course, that's not science. That's not news. Of course, an agent wants to sell new insurance, right?
Right.
But look, the agent knows you're not licensed. You can't sell insurance, sure. Right? Okay, so what can you do? Well, you can find me leads. What kind of leads? Well, the best lead would be a referral. I mean, I love it when I get a referral, and you love it when you get a referral, sure. Right? We love referrals, right? Well, think about it. If I've got 20 losses in a year, and I can only get you out on maybe five of them, if I'm the average, right? Let's just say that, just for a number.
Right.
Be reasonable here. Well, how many out of five do you honestly think you can find actual referrals that are interested in buying my product?
I don't know.
And the answer is
not many.
The answer is not many. And I can show you how to do it, and I can show you that it's important. And you can, if you can get them one in a year, that'd be amazing. Okay. Let's go beyond that. Let's talk about the other type of new business, because they don't know what they don't know in terms of what they're insuring. Let me give you an example.
Okay.
They have this book of business. Many of them they've never met.
Right.
The rest of them they haven't seen for years, and they've never been in anybody's home. So they don't know what they don't know, right?
Exactly.
How many times have I been on a job, you've been on it, anybody listening to this, you know what I'm talking about, where the customer's all upset because they're just in tears because they just last week, the contractor finished remodeling their kitchen.
Yeah.
And I spent $50,000 and this is a mess, and they're all upset, right?
Right.
Think about this. Do you think that customer had a conversation with their agent and said, hey, we've upgraded our home and our value's gone up $50,000? No.
Do you think
the agent would like to know that? Yeah, that's what keeps them awake at night. How about this one? They put on a whole new addition, new room. They add a room. They don't think about calling their agent. They don't have to. Last one. This is my favorite one. And I'll tell you something. If you're listening to this and you spot one of these, it's a golden nugget to take into that agent. They'll like it. They'll sit up in their chair and like you.
Yeah.
Okay. But how many times have I been on a job where somebody, a family, the family has a new family member? Maybe it's, I got a baby, maybe I got a grandbaby. You know, grandparents are always talking crazy about their grandbabies, right? You know, think about it. Do you think the parents or the grandparents think to tell the agent?
No, of course not.
But you know, because you once had to sell life insurance,
right?
Every agent out there wants to know that, and they're buying your name off of a list, and you're sitting there working for them. And some of you there, and some of you right now are listening to this call. You're going, "Oh, I should have. I missed this. How many times have I seen a baby, a new baby, and I haven't even bothered to tell the agent who needs to know, or better still, and I can show you how to do this, get the customer to have a conversation with the agent." Bring them together. Oh my gosh. Now you're bringing gold to them. So when you hear us consultants in this space talk about agent sales and they throw those three things out at you, know this. Yes, they're important. You know, do customer sat retention. Of course it is.
Right.
Tumblr number one, Tumblr number two. Loss ratio, profitability, absolutely, that's important, but it's not enough. It's a myth if you think it is, you're getting fooled. Now, for some of you, it's like, oh, I never thought about letting the agent know. That's a great idea. Please do that. It's a great idea. It's very effective, but I can tell you personally, I've trained people. My partner and I have trained people to do this, and I'm telling you, it's not quite enough. It doesn't open the vault. Okay, so we need one more piece. How are we doing? We got time for one more?
We do.
All right, keep going then. Here you go. Perception is reality, right? We know this.
Right.
Okay. The agent's perception. When I walk through the door as a marketer, as a contractor, as a mitigator, as a whatever you want to call yourself, when I walk through their door, their perception of us is, listen, John, you're a nice guy, but in their head, they're saying, this is a nice guy. I like him, but there's only two things he can do for me. Number one, he can satisfy my customer, and that's important, right? And number two, you can do a good job, do the job right, and that will help me with my loss ratio, and that's important. But they're saying this to themselves, I promise you, you can't do anything else for me.
So now, where do we go from there?
Well, that's it, Wayne, thank you. Boy, you're good. When the agent, you don't have my script, do you?
I don't.
I know you don't. When the agent, and this is how it works, the agent has to change their perception.
Okay.
I can't change that. You know, you can't change somebody against their will. They're of the same opinion still. You know that rhythm. You know that rhyme, right?
Yeah.
You can't, right? But when they change their perception of you, your position with the agent changes. And this is how you go from quote unquote a marketer, which is really a professional office visitor. Sorry, yeah. Somebody probably just clicked delete right now and said, I'm done.
Okay. No, I totally agree.
Expensive, but
totally agree with you.
Yeah. The marketers on the other side of the professional office visitors on the other side of the counter. That's the position you have. When you can cause that agent to change their perception and go, oh my gosh, I should have been doing this 20 years ago. Okay, you get that response. You become a member of the agent's staff. You're part of their team. You're not on their payroll, but you're part of their team.
Yeah.
Now, it's a different game. So your question, let me get you, I know you want to go right here. How do I do that, Jerry, right? Let me give you the answer right now, okay? And the answer is by doing something for the agent. The person now, we're talking about the person, the human, okay, right, that goes beyond their perception. That's what you have to do. And Jonathan, I have to tell you, what I'm about to say is so obvious. It's easy to discount this.
Okay.
So I'm going to tell you, remember the Post-it note.
Okay.
Simple little piece of paper with some fancy glue. Wait a minute. Life before Post-it notes? Some of you are too young to remember what that was like, right?
I'm in that camp. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, who? Don't you wish you were the guy that figured that out? Because it's like, yes. Duh, so obvious, right? That's what I'm about to tell you. It's that obvious. Okay. And if this will help some restorer out there right now today, go for it. Get it done. You will make a difference and you will make progress. So I'm taking a page out of the classic timeless work of a guy named Dale Carnegie. Okay. You've heard of Dale Carnegie?
Oh, yes.
Okay. His classic book. I've got it. I mean, this is on my top shelf book. I read this book every year at least once, How to Win Friends and Influence People. It's not listed in the sales quote unquote books, but it's probably the finest book on sales you'll ever find. And in it, he talks about human beings crave the feeling of importance. Mm-hmm. They crave it. As humans, we crave significance, the feeling of importance. We want to be appreciated, all of those things. Now, what happens, if that's true, I believe it's true, what happens when we do something as restorers for the agent that gives that agent the feeling of importance and significance with their customer during a loss? What happens?
I think their perception might change.
Exactly. Yeah, you change the perception, and therefore you're going to change your position with them. So think about this. The agent has no on-site extension.
Right.
Now, claims does, right?
Sure, they've got the adjuster, yeah.
Yeah, the adjuster, and they've got us as contractors. We represent them, right? Right? Okay, not agents. No one has the agent's back.
Right.
They're a classic salesperson who sold a product and the delivery of the service is completely and entirely out of their control. It's up to the claim department, right? Agents get thrown under the bus, usually by the adjuster. And they do it this way, not directly, it's indirectly, but it sounds like this. It's not my fault you didn't buy sewer and drain coverage.
Right.
Well, if it's not your fault, whose fault is it?
Right.
Now, they'll take it out on us contractors because now they got to pay for this out of their own pocket. They're not happy about that. We pay for that, right? They beat us up over that. But in the end, who's really the guilty party?
Yeah, the agent.
The agent. They got. I mean, it's just like drive the bus over them. Just go ahead. Just, and that's just how the agent feels, right? Yeah. Okay. So if you were to, now I'm going to give you my answer, okay? I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be guilty of that guy that baits you and then makes you call me, okay? I want you, don't call me over this. Call me for something else. But I'm giving you, this is my best, Jonathan. I don't have anything better than what I'm about to give you, I promise you. So somebody who stayed on this call the whole time right now, I hope this helps you if you're listening to this, okay? When you've got a loss and you've identified who that agent is, okay? And if you need help with that, let me know. I'll give you a free little one-page worksheet to help you get the answer, okay? I'll give that to anybody that wants it, okay? But if you call that agent and you say, hey, this is Jerry with such and such company, and we're working for your customer, Mrs. Jones. She's got a water damage. Mm-hmm. Can you pause a little bit and let them go, huh? Who? Oh, no.
Yeah.
Really? Okay. Yeah. I'm going to see her later today. Just something like that. Just use your own words, but I'm going to see her later today. And I wanted to ask you, and I'm going to call you the agent, John.
Sure, I'll be the agent.
John, I just wanted to ask you, since I'm going to go there anyways, and I know you're too busy, you probably can't get out there. I know you would if you could, but John, I'm going to go, and I wanted to ask you, is there any message I could give to your customer on your behalf? Now, I told you it's a post-it note. That's too easy.
Yeah, but I get it.
Think about that feeling that the answer they give, I'm going to talk about next, but the feeling they get, first, you have to be prepared for the awkward silence.
Sure, yeah.
And if you're in person, you can see it. And what the silence is, they're thinking. Their eyes go, oh, boy, that's a new one. You know, right? And nobody's asked them this question. You haven't.
Right.
Right. Your competitors haven't. They're asleep. I mean, this is part of the $4 million equation that I'm going to talk about at the summit. Trust me.
Okay.
Because it's a huge opportunity. But nobody's doing this. So when you say to that customer, or to that agent, you know, is there any message I could give them for you? I'm going to see them. I just, you know, I just want to want you to know I got your back, and I thought maybe there might be something you don't want me to tell. They're going, who are you?
Right.
Who is this? Is this for real? Nobody is this. How do you think they feel?
Yeah, empowered. They feel involved in the process.
Yeah, exactly. So, by the way, let me give you this little piece, because one of the questions you asked me earlier, I said I would get to it. I want to get to it. You asked me, Jerry, how do we separate the clean water from the dirty water bucket?
Right.
Okay. Listen to the way they make you feel in their answer. For example, this is easier. Don't let me give you words. Don't try to think this. Just listen. You'll feel this.
Okay.
If you hear me say something like this, oh, really? Well, that's a good question. Jonathan, tell her I'm sorry that she's got this problem, and if she needs anything, to call me.
Okay.
Versus this. Ready? Who are you? What do you want? No. Call the claim department, Clay.
Right.
Dirty water bucket, clean right. water.
That makes perfect sense.
See it?
Yeah.
I mean, and that's just one of many questions, but that's a gold question. I'm telling you right now, that's one of my best ones, okay? Yeah. I got more, but that will help you sort them out. Quit wasting your time with that one. Focus on this one and see if you can get into that one, right?
Right.
With this kind of a strategy. This is, I'm going to push the envelope of wearing people out on this call.
But that's so okay.
You got to think of this as just a free webinar, okay? That's just a training session. But I do have a full 1-hour course just on this, but that's another topic.
Okay.
Right now, if you take this one step further and the agent tells you something as surface, superficial as, oh, tell them I'm sorry, and if they need anything, call me. Okay, that's superficial. But the way they said it was like, oh, I made them feel good, and they're in the clean water bucket. Okay.
Right.
Now, for that agent, I'm going to do whatever they ask me to do. So guess what? I'm gonna go see that customer, right? Or I'm gonna call them on the phone. Now that's a different paradigm from the marketer who's doing candy drops.
Of course, yeah.
Because now I'm going to go see that customer. I'm gonna talk to that customer, a minimum on the phone, right? For this process, I could do that on the phone, and I'm gonna introduce myself and I'm gonna tell them, you know, I work with your agent, and my job is to work on agency communication. The agents care greatly about you, even though they're not really involved in the claim process itself, blah, blah, blah. And your agent wanted me to be sure and tell you, he's thinking of you, he's sorry you have this loss, or did I embellish that? I'm sorry. you know, make him look good, right?
Right.
Don't lie, but, you know, he's thinking about you, he's sorry you got this loss, and he wanted you to know, wanted me to tell you, if you need anything at all, if you have any questions at all, please, he's there for you, call him.
Yeah.
You have his number? Oh, thank you. So that's really great. Thank you so much. Okay, now you delivered the message, right? Now, a day or two later, this is really fun. Day or two later, what do you think happens when you walk through the door? And this is not a time to use the phone. This is time to walk through the door.
Right.
And you say, oh, you know, I'm Jerry. I called you the other day about Mrs. Smith who had a water dam. Oh, yeah. I remember that. Well, you remember I asked you if there was any message? Oh, yeah, I do remember that. And you say, well, you know, yeah, you asked me to just tell them you're sorry and let them know that, you know, if they had any questions, call me. Yes. Now it all comes back to them.
Right. So
I just want to let you know I did that. And I got to tell you, the look on her face, the tone of her voice, it meant the world to her. I want you to know you made a difference in her life.
Wow.
Now, you're going, that's, wait a minute, that's too simple.
No, it's, but that's okay, because I have calls for hours and hours each day talking about my philosophy of digital advertising. And really, it's stupid simple. We just miss it because it's so obvious.
Yeah.
So I'm all about simple.
Right. Yeah. I mean, this is all I do. I mean, I look at my counterparts and they're doing a lot of other things. I'm not that broad of a consultant. I'm a niche in a niche.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm a specialist at this. This is all I've done for 5 years. I mean, 6 years now. It's crazy. But when you think about this, this is the fourth tumbler, and I felt it in you. I could tell. I saw the tumbler drop, click, Yeah. And you got it. And now what? All you got to do is open the door,
right,
open the handle, pull it open, and walk in. And yeah, now you're now inside on the other side of the counter, part of the team, and they're trying to figure out, how do I get you on my losses, right? How do I beat my own system, right? And the 60%ers already know how to do this. And it's amazing. Now, I got to stop. And you've been great to let me just rant. I get excited.
No, this is good stuff.
This is the tip of the iceberg, Jonathan.
Okay.
On you. Anybody listening to this, test me. Don't believe me. Prove it. Prove me wrong. Go ahead. Tell me you did it. Tell me, yeah, it was awful. You know, the agent, I called four agents and they all told me where to go.
Go pound sand, yeah.
And all I'm going to say is, well, sounds to me like you found, out of a group of 10, you found the four that go in the dirty water bucket. Man, if you quit now, there are six in a row that are going to be in the clean water bucket. That's sales, brother.
Yeah. You know? I totally agree.
And I've never had anybody come back to me and say that didn't work. It doesn't work. It works.
You know, it makes sense. And it's all stuff within our control and influence. And even though it's a simple formula to get yourself onto their team, inside their office, it does make perfect sense.
Yeah.
So, and it's funny because there's 100 programs out there that you can buy into, that still won't do something as effective as just making the agent look like a rock star at that moment of
loss.
And
make them feel right, like a rock star.
They can feel like one.
Yeah. Make them feel like one.
Yeah. No amount of candy, no amount of brochures, no amount of, you know, tchotchkes you drop off is going to ever get
flattery. This is not cheap flattery. This is
not at all.
This is doing something of actual value.
Right.
It's so simple. So simple.
Yeah. And at that moment, you know, I would like to see carriers move back to the model that worked so good for decades, which was that agent involved in the claim process in some way or another, maybe not adjusting, but certainly being involved, because that's, you know, it's not just his insured, it's, or his or her insured, it's their neighbor.
Yeah.
They're part of their community. Why wouldn't they want to be involved?
That's it.
Why outsource that to a call center in Michigan or, you know, overseas? There's no reason behind
there isn't. And that's why in smaller communities, it really isn't 60-40.
Yeah.
It's much greater. The percentage that get involved because of that reason, they're part of the community. Big cities might be a little harder. It's more 60-40, but yeah.
Okay.
Wow. Thank you, brother.
Well, this has been awesome. I know this has been kind of a heady, podcast, but that's great. So let me ask you this. How can people get a hold of you? Where can they go to find you? That's first. So give us that information.
Yeah. Well, obviously if you're in Restoration Rebels, you can get me there.
Yeah.
If you're in LinkedIn, you can get me there. If you want to just go straight to my website, it's just my name with a G, Jerry, G-E-R-R-Y, last name, Edel, E-D-T-L.com, JerryEdel.com.
Okay.
And you get everything there. You can reach me through that, easy enough.
And then you are speaking at the summit on a sort of a, maybe a 102 type course based on this stuff that you've given us today.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what I love about that is you're going to have the opportunity, because I know when you and I first started talking, it was shortly after the Bend, Oregon summit. You were right over the hill and we just kind of missed each other, but you're going to have 25, 30, 40 conversations with restorers who hopefully heard this and started getting those gears moving and thinking this way, and maybe started implementing it. And then they'll get that course at the summit, and you'll be able to talk about, you know, these things with them face to face. That's what I love about the summit, is there are all the different conversations that blossom.
I'm excited. I'm thrilled to be able to go.
That's glad great. To do it. We're stoked to have you. We're honored to have you. And the day we first talked, you struck me as a rebel. even though you come from a not so rebellious background, but it's been good seeing what you've done.
A very good friend of mine will say this used to be a fun industry.
Yeah.
What's happened to it? It's not fun anymore, but
no,
I can tell you, when you can break free from all of that stuff and get your own work and plant an orchard that will grow for years and years and years and years,
Yeah.
I'm telling you, you can have fun again and you can provide for your people and take care of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree. Yeah. Well, Jerry, I appreciate the time again. We will be back. I think our next podcast will drop probably early next week. I may even get it out sooner than that. And we're going to be talking about cybersecurity and cybersecurity insurance. So kind of outside the wheelhouse, but yeah. We realized we've got a lot of small business owners that are probably not thinking that they are a potential risk of something like this, but it's no fun and we thought we'd address it. So listeners, look out for that podcast dropping here in the next few days. But thank you for sticking with us. I hope that you've digested some of this stuff and it has changed your thinking. I know it's changed my thinking on a few bad ideas, a few myths I had believed. But again, Jerry, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
All right. Take care, everyone.